The device that you are watching this video on was made in a factory. Most of the things in your house were made in a factory. Many of their parts were made in one factory and then shipped and assembled in another factory. And all of those factories were made out of pieces that were made in another
factory.
And managing all of that and all of those little moving parts, even the ones that weren't made in literal factories, that's logistics.
When technology knows right where everything goes, that's logistics.
Why am I talking about this? What does this have to do with video games? Well, some people derive a perverse sort of pleasure from games about logistics. I'm one of them. Yes, building conveyor belts and warehouses and trains. Oh yes, trains. And factories. Oh yes, we've got Satisfactories and Infinifactories and Factorios. And all this stuff is great. You're gonna see why. You're gonna believe me. There's nothing wrong with liking these games. Nothing wrong. Nothing except the severe addictive qualities they can have. I mean, hours gone. But that's not what this video is about. This video is about how these sorts of games can actually teach you a lot about how a real-world system of logistics works. You remember all of those factories, right? But what's
weird
is that these complicated video games are getting better and better at explaining our wacky world of logistics, not because they're becoming better, more refined simulations, but because our actual real-world supply chain is becoming more and more like a video game. Which is If you're feeling a little lost at how overwhelming logistics can seem, don't worry. That's actually a great metaphor for how you usually start in a logistics game.
With nothing.
Well, except maybe a verdant, untouched planet teeming with bountiful resources for you to exploit. And oh boy, are you gonna exploit those resources. It's like the main thing you do in these games. Why? To make something out of it. Why? To survive and or make a profit. Cold hard cash. So you start simple, chopping down trees and picking up plants. It's slow at first, mining resources manually. You might even think at this point that these are survival games like The Forest or Valheim, but you've got more on your mind than just base survival. You've got a goal. Maybe you're building a way to escape from this bug-infested planet. Or maybe something big, like a Dyson sphere, or a global terraforming project. And so you gotta exploit those resources, dude. Except, exploiting resources is kinda boring. Which might seem weird, since it's like the main thing in these games. It's just that these games actually want it to be kinda boring, because that's what finally encourages you to automate it. Let me give you an example. Say you want a metal rod. Instead of mining iron yourself, you'd rather build something that does it for you. And instead of running around delivering iron ore to your smelters, you'd rather make a conveyor belt do it for you. And instead of forging your own metal rods, you'd rather a factory forge one for you. Congratulations! That's logistics. You've made a supply chain with the raw materials for each step being sent onward to the next. As you research and unlock new technology, that supply chain grows more and more complex. You discover and exploit new resources, requiring the construction of entirely new supply chains. You have to start traveling further to find those resources, and you probably need to dramatically increase the supply of energy for all of those new factories you're building. Your transportation system becomes bigger and faster by necessity as the recipes you're making become longer and more complex. Frankly, it all gets really, really, really messy. But you've got to increase efficiency if you ever want to finish that big project and/or get off this damn rock. See those empty conveyor belts over there? That means you're not producing stuff fast enough. And those conveyor belts over there that are
full? That's even worse!
Those are resources that
aren't
being exploited. And that's wasted potential. So you build more factories to take use of those resources, so there's never any slack in the system. Your growing factory starts to operate more and more like clockwork, with everything you need arriving at just the right time, in just the right amounts. You hardly make any of your own resources anymore. You have factories to make your factories for you, and blueprints to standardize them. With enough time and dedication to improving your factory, that seemingly impossible goal becomes achievable. And that's a basic summary of how logistics games work. But what if I told you that I've been secretly educating you because I just gave you a basic history of
logistics?
It's a little uncanny how much the player progression in logistics games matches with the history of logistics, which is usually divided into three revolutions. The first logistics revolution was when humans began to master agriculture, exploiting nature to grow our own food, harvest energy resources, and craft simple tools to make all this easier for us. Oh, and also do war. Historians point to things like food storage and fielding large armies as incredible feats of ancient logistical planning. Soldiers need food and water and swords and shit, and somehow they did this all before
trains.
Amazing. Well, the wars were terrible, but logistically impressive. And then, after a lot of hours of game time, I mean civilization building, the rise of industrial manufacturing brings about the second logistical revolution. Higher density energy, like coal and oil, allows humans to power wicked, smoke-belching machines that take jobs from skilled craftsmen and make a bunch of crap really fast. King Lud tried to warn us. Once far away, resources became accessible, especially if you had an empire and could just say, "Oh, cheerio! That's a nice spot of land you got over there. Looks like a lot of delicious ores. I think I'll take it." Anyway, these factories were a pretty big deal. Pretty soon, people are beeping around the world with telegraphs, London's a shithole, and oh yeah, we got
trains.
But we weren't done with our big project, creating modern society, just yet. First, we needed to invest a lot of research points into things like jet propulsion and massive container ships. That tech allowed us to ship stuff globally really fast or really cheap. In 1968, we unlocked the 20x8x8 standard cargo container. Give it up for the standard cargo container. Now, ports across the world could all be designed to handle the same shape of cargo, a shape that could easily be put on the train or truck bed. Altogether, these innovations exponentially increased how much stuff we could move around the globe. But what pains me to say as someone who really appreciates a good train and will settle for a big boat, is that information technology was probably an even bigger deal. As FedEx founder Fred Smith put it, the information about the package is as important as the package itself. Man, he should have put that into practice. Or as UPS puts it in their incredibly educational advertisement,
when technology knows right where everything goes,
that's logistics. Where everything goes, that's logistics. Knowing precisely where something is and when it will arrive allowed our logistical system to evolve once again.
Welcome to Jurassic Park.
The third logistical Welcome to the third logistical revolution. By tracking more things digitally, bottlenecks could be quickly identified and alleviated so that the flow of materials and products could move even faster. No more empty or backed up conveyor belts. Instead, everything arrives just in time in just the right amounts. Or more precisely, that's just in time manufacturing. This strategy for running a factory supply chain was invented and implemented by Toyota engineer Taichi Ono in the 1930s, but spread globally in the 1970s. IT technology made implementing just-in-time logistics way easier, while the cost savings in warehousing, manufacturing waste, and labor made it irresistible to manufacturers.
There'll be cheers on Wall Street, that's logistics.
And this is where our modern logistics system comes into focus. Manufacturing robots make factories run like clockwork, while the internet and e-commerce make global trade accessible to the average person. Everything is quantified, tracked, and analyzed. We've got so much data that we start modeling how pears can get bruised in their shipping boxes. Factories are supplying factories that are supplying factories in a massive global supply chain where everything arrives just in time.
I continue with Link that is always in sync, that's logistics.
And nothing could possibly go wrong. Hey, what the fuck is that? Just-in-time logistics is kind of amazing when you think about it. It's like an incomprehensibly large juggling act, with every component landing back in the clown's hand at just the right time, only to be sent back into the air seconds later. Now, what happens when the clown gets COVID? As much as just-in-time logistics sounds like a house of cards ready to fall over at any moment, it's actually pretty adaptable. If a hurricane looked like it was going to delay a shipment of sprockets to one of your factories, you could order up a batch of gizmos from a different supplier, and then everything would continue running smoothly? More or less? Most of the time? The problem is that the system had a harder time coping with a disaster happening to everyone, everywhere, all at once. And even worse was trying to get it started up again in the face of resurgent COVID variants and a new land war in Eastern Europe. Even though pandemics and wars aren't something you have to worry about in these games, they can illustrate some things about how hard it is to restart a supply chain. I've got a perfect example from my Satisfactory playthrough. At a certain point, I added one factory too many and my power grid failed. Restarting it wasn't as simple as just flipping a switch back on. I needed to get power to my water pumps and coal mines before my power plants could restart, which required creating a smaller power grid running off of burnt leaves just to jumpstart my main power grid. Which is all to say, when disaster struck, restarting this one production line took a lot of work. And in a really simplistic way, this is what it's like restarting factories in the real world. Because a lot of them practically break down when they're not running. Chemical storage tanks have to be flushed and then filled and then cleaned and then filled again, or else they might corrode. Dust and mold gather on the inside of machines as they sit unused, and I don't want dust and mold on my metal rods. And because of how much precision timing there is on an assembly line, every individual step must be brought back online in a very specific order. So imagine what that's like when there's thousands of supply chains all starting up at once. The system's adaptability was also strained after things got restarted. Even when manufacturers caught up with demand, there weren't enough shipping containers to ship everything. And then there wasn't enough room at ports to unload everything. And speaking of shipping containers and ports, there was also that really big boat. They got stuck in the Suez Canal. The big boat got stuck. You could not plan a more appropriate dummy-thick metaphor for the way our logistics system has been designed, with an ever-growing demand for more stuff. So we've upgraded our container ships with bigger and bigger designs. The Ever Given is literally one of the biggest ships ever built. And it got stuck. The big boat got stuck. And it got stuck. The big boat got stuck. When you've played these sorts of games, you can kinda understand why we went for the mega huge container ships perk. I mean, I would. I'd go to high speed rail because, you know, trains, but big boats are cool too. But the other thing players can see here is the bottleneck. The Suez Canal, finished in 1869, was built long before anyone could have ever dreamed up an absolute unit like the Ever Given. And so, not for the first time, the canal had to be upgraded to keep pace with the explosive growth of big boats. But the shock to the supply chain wasn't just about the boats that got stuck or the factories that shut down or the overloaded ports. It was also about the people that worked there. The pandemic affected people very differently depending on where they worked. I was one of the lucky ones who got to work from home. Most supply chain jobs can't be done from home. These people risked their lives to keep the supply chain moving instead of completely collapsing. And they risked them again as the global logistics system started clawing its way back. Things were harder than ever, and labor issues that weren't great before the pandemic got way, way worse. Understandably, a lot of people left these sorts of jobs, making the labor shortage slash not paying people enough crisis even worse. Lots of people who remained fought for better treatment, not everyone got it. And for the most part, the response has not been more generous wages or expanded benefits or safer working conditions. But you know what has expanded? Gamification. Turns out gamifying a job works best when the tasks are repetitive, like say, packing metal rods in a warehouse. Gamifying that process with points and leaderboards reportedly keeps workers focused and happier. It is also dehumanizing, as though they are little creatures driven by treats and the spray. And if gamifying doesn't increase productivity to your liking, with enough automation and digification, you can take the human element out completely. factory robots have been around for decades, but more and more warehouses have turned to robots for their labor. Autonomous cargo trucks are now viewed as something of a holy grail in an industry with a long-running and pandemic-exacerbated labor shortage. And boy, do I hate saying this, but I get it. That's the whole gameplay loop in this genre. This is boring. I don't like having to do this. How can I automate this process so I don't have to do it anymore? But like I said at the beginning of the video, there's nothing wrong with liking these games. Nothing wrong. I don't think that's a bad thing. In a video game. In fact, I think it's cool that human brains get enjoyment from solving little problems. We like to fix things. And that's really the core game loop of logistics games. Solving a problem so effectively that you never have to deal with it again. Only so that you can go find another problem to solve. It's self-interested, yes, but in the same way that it's self-interested to use a dishwasher to make doing the dishes easier. But Jeffy B doing it, well, it hits different. Sure, the drive to gamify warehouses and automate package delivery is an attempt to solve a problem in the same way you automate to solve problems in these games. It's just that the problem being solved here is that human laborers need things like bathroom breaks and sick days and predictable scheduling and all of that decency ultimately costs a big chunk of change. The incentive isn't to save Bezos some personal labor or even give him the pleasure of creating a perfect little system in a consequence-free environment. It's just fiduciary, a responsibility to stockholders to make the most money. Logistics games try to grapple with the endless cycle of expansion and exploitation, oftentimes in ways that reflect our reality. Satisfactory and Railgrade offer a critique of corporate indifference by putting you to work for a megacorp that clearly doesn't think of you as much more than another cog in its machine. And the games that don't directly contend with the moral implications of your resource harvesting at least give you a goal that's more erudite than simple profit, like building a Dyson sphere or terraforming a planet and taking care of the people who live there. And yet, it's this very drive to automate that's made our logistics system feel more and more like a video game. The software that runs these warehouses looks like it would fit right in. Of course, outside of the controlled environments of a warehouse or factory, automation gets a lot trickier. Real life doesn't work as flawlessly as a video game. I'm just saying that those little delivery robots don't inspire a lot of confidence. And I bet I'll be completely pancaked by an autonomous semi-truck long before railroad workers can get more than a few days of sick leave. The fourth logistics revolution sure is gonna be fun. I do want to reiterate that despite these games sounding like rapacious capitalism simulators, I don't think playing them makes you a bad person. They use elegant game design to craft a satisfying problem-solving experience. Some of the player progression in these games is the smartest I've seen across any genre because of how much they trust the player to solve problems through experience. They're also typically a chill place to just spend time. I've watched like four seasons of Deep Space Nine while playing Satisfactory.
Workers of the world, unite!
And for me personally, it's incredibly gratifying to see some massive structure being built in the sky or a dead planet bloom thanks to your countless hours of effort. Some even tell shockingly good stories within the context of logistics. But as far as our real-world system of logistics becoming more and more like a video game, don't do that. I don't need same-day shipping on my metal rods. It's fine. Could wait a couple days.